Namaste and welcome to Indian Literary Classics. Kalidasa was a legendary poet, widely regarded as Sanskrit's greatest playwright ever, who drew his inspiration from the Mahabharata and the Puranas. Although there are not many historical evidences that point to the exact period or region of Kalidasa's existence, it is believed that his works were authored around the 4th to 5th century AD. He was considered among the 9 gems of King Vikramaditya of Ujjain. He is best known for some of his famous plays, Abhijnana Shakuntala, Meghaduta, Raghuvamsa, and Kumarasambhava. Kalidasa's writing style is characterized by simple use of Sanskrit with extensive use of similes. Kalidasa's poetry paints a beautiful imagery of various characters and situations, and he enhances it with his use of similes. Kumarasambhava is considered to be Kalidasa's best work and also the greatest long poem written in Sanskrit ever. Only Raghuvamsa, also written by Kalidasa, comes close. Although there is no specific evidence that gives us the exact period when Kumarasambhava was written, but it is believed to have been somewhere around the 4th to 5th century when it was penned down. Kumarasambhava means the birth of Kumara, also known as Kartikeya, the son of Shiva and Parvati. The epic Kumarasambhava contains about 17 cantos or sargas. The word canto is derived from the Italian word song and is usually considered a logical division in long-form poetry. A canto is typically several hundred lines long. Scholars still debate whether all the 17 cantos in Kumarasambhava was actually written by Kalidasa. A popular belief is that Kalidasa probably wrote only the first 8 and the rest 9 was completed by someone else. This was due to the difference in the writing style and use of vocabulary in the poem. Kalidasa is a nature lover and starts by describing the Himalayas in the north and how tall its peaks cleaves through the sky and spans the entire land from east to west. The Mother Earth chose these hills to fill with rich minerals and precious herbs. Phosphorus plants light up caves and its mouth, and such is the beauty of the King of Hills. He is called Himavan and is married to Menavati. Over a period of time, they had 2 children, Mainaka and Uma. Uma, who was Sati in her prior life, was married to Shiva. I'm going to take a small digression here to tell the story of, you know, Sati and how she came to be Uma in her later life. It was said that when Daksha, Sati's father, insulted Shiva, Sati had immolated herself in her father's sacrificial fire. Shiva becomes very angry at hearing this and cuts Daksha's head and destroys his kingdom. Vishnu then pacifies Shiva, who forgives Daksha and revives him with the head of a goat. Shiva is full of grief and wanders around with Sati's body. Vishnu realizes that Shiva has the power to destroy all the 3 worlds. He pacifies him and convinces him that he should lay Sati's body to rest. Vishnu then cuts Sati's body with his discus, which scatters around. These places where Sati's body fell came to be known as Shakti Peetams. Sati takes rebirth as Uma, or Parvati as we know her, to Himavan and Menavati so that she can get reunited with Shiva again. Uma's beauty was unparalleled. Kalidasa describes her as someone who was bright as a lotus, shedding radiance wherever she went, and her anklets made the hills resound with music. One day, sage Narada sees Uma and knows that Uma is Sati reborn and should be reunited with Shiva. He goes to Himavan and tells him that Uma is destined to be Shiva's wife. Shiva, however, had renounced the world after Sati's death and becomes an ascetic. On Narada's advice, Himavan asks Uma to serve Shiva and get his blessings. Around that time, the gods were troubled by this fierce demon called Taraka, who, after severe penances, gets a boon from Brahma and considers himself immortal. The gods, led by Indra, pray to Brahma, who says Neither Vishnu nor I have the power to take on Taraka. Only Shiva can relieve us of this pain. He has become a hermit and leads a very quiet life in the Himalayas. Go to him and get him attracted to the beautiful Uma, for only a child born out of their union can destroy Taraka. Indra calls upon Kama, the god of love who is decked in garlands and whose hands is a bow made with lovely flowers. The bow of love is Kama's famous weapon that never misses its mark. Kama asks, "O king of gods, what is your command?" Indra says, "The gods desire a commander-in-chief who is born from Shiva. Shiva is a recluse now in the Himalayas and he is being served by Uma, the beautiful daughter of Himavan. Go there and make Shiva fall in love with Uma." Kama goes to Shiva's ashram in the Himalayas with his wife Rati. Kama sees Shiva sitting still on his tiger skin, eyes closed and deep in meditation. Shiva opens his eyes slowly and sees the beautiful maiden who is attending on him each day. He speaks gently to Uma. "O lovely maiden, I am pleased with your devotion. You shall be blessed with a husband who loves no one but you." Uma smiles and offers Shiva a rosary of lotus beads. Right at that moment, Kama, who is hiding, mounts a love arrow on his flowery bow and fires it at Shiva. For a moment, the arrow takes its effect and Shiva feels love building up towards Uma. When through a sheer power of will, attained through years of meditation, Shiva controls his emotion and seeks out angrily. He finds Kama decked with flowers and smiling gently. Shiva is furious, opens his third eye, and Kama turns to ashes instantly. Uma feels really sad and shameful at this and cries, "Oh, what is the use of this beauty when it can't attract the eyes of the behold?" Here is where Kalidasa's description and his explanation is at its best. You can actually feel being part and be in front of Shiva and Uma as they go through their emotions. Rati falls into a swoon when she sees Kama turn into ashes. When she recovers, she is overcome with grief and smears Kama's ash all over her body and prepares to jump into a funeral pyre. As she is about to jump, a heavenly voice calls and comforts her, saying, "O wife of Kama, preserve your body. The very reason Kama was burned by Shiva's third eye will be the reason for him to come back alive again. You are destined to be reunited with your husband." Rati awaited that moment when she can be together with Kama again. Uma, in the meantime, tells her father Himavan that she wishes to stay in the forest and observe severe penances so that she can win the heart of her Lord Shiva. One day, as she was deep in meditation, a young handsome hermit comes to her and asks the reason for such a beautiful maiden to observe such severe austerities. Uma replied that she wants to win over the heart of her Lord Shiva. To this, the young hermit speaks about Shiva in a very derogatory way and says, "How can a pretty woman like you marry an ugly looking hermit?" Uma gets very angry and asks the hermit to stop immediately and move away. The young hermit was actually Shiva. He shows his true form and says, "O beautiful one, you have won my heart through your penances and I am now your slave." As Shiva says this, Uma's fatigue disappears altogether and she appears very happy and cheerful. Shiva then goes to the Saptarishis and requests them to ask Himavan to bestow Uma's marriage with him. The Saptarishis actually feel really blessed at this request coming from the Supreme Lord, and thus Shiva gets reunited with Sati, who is born as Uma or as Parvati as we know her. Shiva and Parvati spend several happy days with each other in the Gandhamandana mountains after their wedding. In the meanwhile, Agni takes the form of a pigeon, enters their chambers, and on behalf of all the devas, seeks a commander-in-chief who can kill the demon Taraka. Shiva gives his seed to the fire god as it will be too hot for anyone else to handle. Agni also couldn't bear the heat and carries the seed to Indra, who advises him to cast it into the Ganga, who will make it pure. Even Ganga is unable to bear it, and she deposits the fire seed into a lake in a forest full of reeds, where it forms into 6 babies. The local tribeswomen, known as Kritikas, find these babies and take care of them. This is also the reason why Kumara is called Kartikeya. There is an intense debate going on between Agni, Ganga and the Kritikas when Shiva and Parvati arrive at the lake. Parvati then embraces those babies and it becomes a single body with 6 faces, Shanmukha. As Parvati is wondering how she is going to cuddle a child with 6 faces, the child transforms into a single radiant face and smiles back at Parvati. Kumara grows into a strong and intelligent boy. Indra and all the gods come over to Shiva's place and bow to the Lord. Shiva looks at Kartikeya and smiles and he says, "On being requested by all the gods, I am appointing you as the commander-in-chief of Indra's army. Go and destroy the evil Taraka." Kumara accepts his father's command and bows to his parents. Parvati then gives him her Shakti in the form of a spear as his weapon, and it is believed that the festival of Thai Pusam in Tamil Nadu and other parts of Southeast Asia is celebrated as a significance of this event. Kartikeya then takes leave of his parents and goes to get the blessings from Kashyapa, one of the Saptarishis. With a great war cry, Kartikeya and the Deva army march towards Taraka, raising so much dust that it creates a twilight atmosphere during daytime. When the demons heard that Kartikeya was marching towards them, they trembled with fear. A great battle ensues, and finally Taraka and Kartikeya come face to face with each other. Taraka mocks at Kartikeya and says, "Child, I am invincible. You are fighting against all odds. Just retreat from this battle." The son of Shiva unleashes his Shakti on Taraka and severs his head. Indra and the other gods are overjoyed and congratulate Kartikeya. Thus, the purpose of Kumara's birth was accomplished. A shower of kalpa flowers fall upon Kumara. Kalidasa's poetry exudes his love for nature. Throughout this epic, as you would have realized, Kalidasa's signature elaboration, such as the description of the Himalayas, the beauty of the flora, fauna around, and his ability to describe the emotions, actually transports us as readers. We feel as if all these events are unfolding in front of our own eyes. His style of writing is still considered as one of the best examples of long-form poetry. Hope you all like this presentation. Please hit the like button if you did and consider subscribing to this channel. I'm leaving some links in the description below so that you can pick up a copy of this great epic and enjoy it in its full form. If you are up to it, there is also a Sanskrit version available as well as the translated ones. Namaste and Jai Hind. See you soon.